Participate in there, a nice symposium on glaucoma progression monitoring with perimetry. I use the Humphrey as well as the Octopus. I think I was chosen to speak on this because I'm the one who probably does more on the Octopus than among the others. And obviously, we would all like to predict, like Paul, the Octopus, as to whether this is progression or not, whether this is glaucoma and this is progression. That's all we all aim to do with the diagnostic tests. And the interesting part, I'll just talk briefly about the Octopus before we go on to progression analysis with the Octopus. The Octopus was the world's first automated perimeter. And a lot of history and timeline in the Octopus. The 1998, you had the 123, which was in use for a long time. I still have the 123, which is in use. The Octopus 300 became much more popular thereafter. I think many of us still use the Octopus 300 a lot for our current glaucoma practice. And now the latest to come to the list of what we have in Octopus machines is the Pulsar, the 600 Pulsar, the TFT touchscreen, and no chin rest, and very modern looking gadget with the Pulsar perimeter. These are all the various machines available with the Octopus. This is the Hackstreet's Goldman. It all evolved from the Hackstreet Goldman, and this is still a Hackstreet company. The difference, essential difference between direct projection systems and the cupola type system is the difference in the way the light is projected, and that there is a difference. It's a direct projection system, this is a cupola based system, the Humphrey that is. There are small differences in the way the test is done, small differences in the background luminance, small differences in the test strategy and all that, but essentially both give you the similar kind of information. Except that the most important factor to consider is that the brightest stimulus which the Octopus 300 can produce is about 4,800 apostils, whereas the Humphrey's brightest about 10,000 apostils. So obviously you're going to have a brighter stimulus. The stimulus duration is going to be different. So you can't really use one perimetry's report and compare with the Humphrey's report and then say this is progression or not. I put this in mainly to show that these two perimeters test differently, so you can't really look at two different printers from two different machines and then judge progression. And the testing strategies, besides the strategy, the extent of field tested is also different. The glaucoma program of the Octopus will have a slightly different way of testing. Number of points tested in the central field is much more dense than the ones in the periphery and the aqueate areas compared to the standard 6-degree grid of the Humphrey perimetry. The strategies are similar. The dynamic strategy is equivalent of the CETA. The top is equivalent of the CETA FAST. And good reliability, good fixation monitoring, active trackers are all features of the Octopus. And the field printouts can be in color with the Octopus, of course. It doesn't make much difference the color, but it's nice to impress upon the patient sometimes. And the additional factor here is the defect curve, which is additional factor which is not found in the Humphrey printouts. The defect curve is actually ranking of all tested points from rank 1 to rank 59. The rank 1 is the first rank, the rank 59 is the least, the most deviated point and so on. This will give you an idea as to what is going on in the overall field. The ISUR is the software which is used in the Octopus to actually determine and give us a statistical analysis for whether it's a single field, whether it's the progression analysis and so on. This is the ISUR. And it is capable of taking data from any of the Octopus perimeters. It can also take data and input from the Humphrey perimeter as well. If you have a Humphrey perimeter in your networking, suppose you have a clinic with five different consulting rooms, one has Humphrey, one has the 123, one has the 300, you can network all of them and the data can be analyzed by ISUR. Similarly, you also have what is called as a 7-in-1 printout, which you most often use for single fields. We can also generate a Humphrey-style printout from the Octopus. We can, of course, do the cluster analysis of what's happening in 10 different clusters on the visual field using the cluster analysis. And the polar graph can show you where the visual field defect is, on, for example, like this. It can convert it to why we expect the change in structure to be and correlate with the HRT change, like you're going to expect an NFL defect, a notch in the rim, and so on. This is structure function correlation using the polar diagram. And I think we've gone through this as the normal rate of decay of visual decay and for a normal patient could be as low as about 0.07. And if you're maybe in a glaucoma patient, it could be a little more, about 0.6 decibels per year. But if you're going to have advanced glaucoma, you're going to have untreated glaucoma, it's going to progress much more. So the idea of actually looking for progression is that we want to pick up this rate of progression and see who is progressing rapidly and who is progressing at what we call as a normal visual decay. We can do this many ways, looking at the optic disc and clinical examination. You can look at the visual field. I think we've gone through how we can use statistical methods to look at progression. And of course, you can look at progression using imaging techniques as well. And I would suggest you all look up this wonderful publication on progression called the World Glaucoma Association Consensus book on the progression of glaucoma. It gives you a very elaborate, very detailed evidence-based methods of looking at progression analysis in glaucoma. The general guidelines for looking at progression using visual fields is there, as you think we already discussed that earlier, but several fields particularly to establish a baseline. And then repeat fields many times, the publication which I think Mona referred to about the Chauhan's publication, which says that about first 3 years you get about 6 fields to particularly identify the rapid progressor and whether it's a slow progressor or not. And then of course use the same strategy and extent. If you're using the octopus perimetry, make sure you're using either dynamic or the top and the G program. Don't keep changing the strategies and the extent of field tested. And of course you can use the iSuit in the octopus. The older versions were the peri data and the peri trend, and which you no longer use now. If you have the iSuit, you're not using the others. And of course you have the overview and you have the trend analysis. The overview is just eyeballing the fields over time, and you just look at the sequence of, say this is about 15, 16 fields done over time. You can look at just what is happening, and the grayscale itself and the corrected loss variance here would tell you that something is going on, obviously the field is worsening. But obviously it is not enough to just look at consecutive visual fields and judge that this is worsening. Like you said, could this be fluctuation, could this be progression? Is it inter-test or intra-test changes, or is it really a real change in the glaucoma is actually worsening? It's very difficult for us to say sometimes, just looking at consecutive visual fields. So obviously we need to have a progression analysis to distinguish between progression and fluctuation. In the octopus perimeter, you will have the mean defect, is the overall field getting worse. Or you have the square loss variance. Does it get worse because of a local defect? And if in this, the SLV will start increasing. Whereas if you have a diffuse defect, the SLV will remain constant. So this is one way of looking at the mean defect and looking at the trend over time. And this will give you what is happening in this particular patient. So you have the trend analysis, both the global and the local defect, which is possible using the octopus machines. The mean defect is equivalent of the mean deviation. The corrected loss variance is equivalent of the PST in the Humphrey perimeter. The diffuse defect and the local defect is the one which is unique to the octopus perimeter. This is based on the defect curve. And there's a cluster trend, of course, and there's also the polar trend, which is a point-based linear regression analysis. All this is unique to the octopus perimeter. If you look at one of our patients, is actually progressing over time. If you look at the mean defect, this is the left eye and the right eye of the same patient. You can look at this red arrow, which is showing a downward trend in 5 fields done from 2010 onwards. This is a gradual downward trend. This red arrow indicates a downward trend. This is the mean defect. This is the loss variance equivalent of the PSD. This is the diffuse defect, and this is the local defect. All of them are showing a downward trend. This is fluctuation. In this, you can actually look at the slope, that is the rate of progression in decibels per year, and also look at the fluctuation, which is unique to the octopus. You can actually get what is the extent of fluctuation which is happening in several fields over time. This you probably will not get with the Humphrey printout. Calculating a yearly progression rate in decibels per year and its significance is marked like this. This, as I showed you, this red arrow pointing downwards is worsening at the 1% significance level. The arrow alone without the hollow arrow here is worsening at the 5% level. And improvement is, of course, in green. The fluctuation is in this kind of a diamond, the open diamond or the closed diamond is the 1% significance level. You'll also get the slope in decibels per year with a significance p-value. And also you'll get the fluctuation with the p-value. So this is actually very useful for us if we have many fields over time to look at the rate and the trend of what is happening. The other important thing I think we are also discussing that we should actually set and reset baselines. We should exclude unreliable fields. We should exclude fields which are not done well during the patient, by the patient during the many fields he has done. We can actually select and deselect the test. So for example, you look at this number of tests being done from 2000 to 2005, multiple tests done over time. If you look at the slope, you will find the slope is 0.9 decibels per year, the fluctuation 1.7. But if you actually want to look at the last 5 or 6 tests, you look at the trend here and this becomes 1.9 decibels. This is far more significant than where he started off. So it's more useful to look at the timeline of the last 5-6 tests in your clinical interest if you really want to know the patient is worsening by resetting the timeline and choosing the time window and making sure that you're actually looking at recent change rather than the change from the beginning from where we started off. That is one. The second thing is if you have multiple tests again done from say 1995 to 2005 like this, and if you have again multiple tests, you make sure that you're using the last 5 to 6 relevant tests, and you make sure you deselect and remove the tests which you think are not appropriate. Again, one more example of trend over several years, multiple fields done over time. The actual trend shows a little recovery, but if you look at this, it's showing a downward trend. So if you look at the last 5-6 tests, you'll actually show an upward arrow. That's what I think we are talking about. This upward trend could be a significant fluctuation as well. So you look at this another example of the same fluctuation looking at an upward trend. So long-term trends may actually underestimate, overestimate progression. If you're going to look at very many fields over time and looking at the slope, but what you should do is you should optimize between the significance and the actuality of the trend, the last 5-6 examinations, which is relevant to your clinical practice, rather than looking at the entire timeline of 10 years or 15 years and whatever. But the exception, of course, is that if you're going to have a trend over many more tests, the progression rate is small, then you will not pick it up. So make sure you do use at least 5 or 6 tests for you to look at the progression analysis. And the cluster trend, coming to the cluster trend, the cluster actually is a very interesting concept. This is one patient I think we already showed you, a deterioration, a downward red arrow in the last 5-6 tests, and the slope is 1.9 decibels per year. But if you look at the same patient's cluster analysis of points tested in the 10 clusters which the octopus can analyze, you can look at which of the clusters is actually deteriorating more significantly than the other. This is 10 areas of 10 clusters of areas which are being tested. And if you look at this, 1.9 is the average of all the clusters put together. But whereas if you look at each area separately, you look at there's a range of about 0.8 to 6.7 decibels in different clusters. You know, which is the cluster which is actually deteriorating more? And similarly, if we can, this is another comparison of the cluster trend versus the global trend. Just one more, few more slides, I think. The last about comparing, suppose you have a cataract in between, a patient's confounded by cataract in between, and you find that there's obvious worsening of the field due to cataract, and this corrected cluster trend can actually judge the glaucoma independent of the cataract. This is a unique feature of the octopus cluster trend as well. This is the corrected cluster trend, which actually shows you that things are actually getting better, mainly the changes because of the cataract. This is comparing both the Humphrey and the octopus slide differences. I think we discussed what the octopus does. And lastly, I think just to stress upon the, whenever there's a new treatment or a surgery is done, you must reset the baseline. Whenever this field is unreliable, do not include in the progression analysis. And of course, whenever you feel that a field is not reliable, like I said, you make sure it is repeated and then added to the chain of testing in the progression analysis. Thank you very much.